Okay, let's get started. We're in the spatial senses visual system. Your visual system pick up light, visible light, and it's a very small range in all the electromagnetic wave. If you look at the electromagnetic wave, start from the gamma ray, X-ray, UV, and this small range, this is actually too big. It's very small. It's very small. This is called the visible light from the about 350 to 700 nanometer. That's a very small range. And then it will go to the infrared, go to the heat, microwave, radio, television. This is all electromagnetic wave, and we can see very small range. We call them visible light because only this small range light, they are able to activate our photoreceptor, which is rods and cones. We have two of them, and be able to they're able to transfer this wavelength of light into neurotransmitter release first and then into action potential. This is why we call them visible light. So if I give you a lot of infrared, well, you're going to burn your skin, but you don't know what's going on because your rods and cones won't be able to transfer them into action potential. So turn out you don't see them. The same for the UV. I give you a lot of UV and cause skin cancer and you still don't know what's going on. So we have very small range, and some animals, insects, are able to see this because they have the photoreceptor be able to pick up this. So that's the visible light range. And let's look at the eye. So the eye, its job is to pick up the light and make sure they focus perfectly on the retina. So in the whole eye structure, the most important one is this piece of paper called retina. It's a piece of paper in the back of the eyeball. And you can cause detachment in some athletes. They've been hit in the eye too much. It can cause the shaking of the eyeball too much. So the inside is all water. It's more like a gel called the vitreous humor. It's like a jello, but it's mainly water. And they use the water to push the retina in the same position. But you can shape the eyeball too much, like some boxer. They hit the eye. And turn out they're blind. The reason is this piece of paper detach. And once they detach, no matter how hard you try to focus, the light won't focus perfectly on the retina and they're blind. That's how the sports cause blindness. And all this structure, the lens, the others, all of them make sure the light perfectly focus on the retina. So on the retina, this area called the fovea, this is the one giving you the sharpest vision. And this area is actually called the blind spot. And that's where the nerves, the optic nerves, all the axons from all these neurons combine together, go out through the cranial nerve number 2, optic nerve go out. So this area, we don't have any photoreceptor. So actually they are blind here. It's called the blind spot. You don't feel like you have blind spot because your brain fool you. Your brain gonna take the image next to it, average, create a illusion. So you don't feel like you have blind spot, but actually you do. And the light need to focus perfectly on the retina. So you're gonna go through the cornea. Cornea, this part, this where you put your contact lenses you touch. And gonna go through the lens. The lens is gonna be the main one to change the curvature to focus the light. So ideally you need to focus the light perfectly like this. But we have some people, they have some, like me, have the nearsighted. So it turned out the light just won't be able to focus perfectly. So you need to have the other structure, like put the concave lens here to make the light diverge out first, then they can focus. Eventually they want to focus perfectly on here. And we have the LASIK surgery is change the curvature of the cornea, so use it to replace the lens you're wearing. Pretty good success rate, about 95% success rate. I don't want to be the 5%, so I don't do the surgery, but it's pretty safe. And ideally your lens able to change the curvature, so we don't change the distance. And that's the camera. So if you play with the camera, you take a picture of the near object, the lens actually move out So it changed the distance because the a closer object, the light diverged out more. And we could not change this distance, so we changed the curvature. So it turned out the light have to, if the object come from the front, you have to make the lens round like a ball so we can change the curvature. And they're able to do that because of this muscle, a subroncal ciliary muscle. It's gonna pull the lens. If you want it to be round, you have to make the muscle tight, contract the muscle. So like you use your cell phone a lot, you use the tablet a lot. After a few hours, you feel like, oh, my eyes sore because you contract this too much, make the lens round. And you gradually lose this power. So if you use the tablets too much, use your eye too much, you gradually lose this power. And when you lose this power, you found some old people, they forget their reading glasses. That's why when you need your reading glasses, and they forget the reading glasses, they have to put the object pretty far, be able to read. And the reason is a far object, the light is more parallel, so they don't have to make the lens curve that much, so they can still focus perfectly on the retina. They just won't be able to make it curve enough to read the close object. So when you get older, you gradually lose the power to read the object closer to you. And then let's focus on the retina. That's the most important place. So the whole eyeball is most important job is to transfer the light into the neurotransmitter release and the action potential. And it happens on the retina. Retina is a piece of paper, but it's actually three layers of cells. There are five different kinds of cells, but three layers. The rods and cones. So that's the photoreceptor, bipolar, and ganglia. And when you look at the design, it's actually not very smart because they put it ganglia, then bipolar, then rods and cones. So when the light comes, they will hit the ganglia, hit the bipolar. Even though they're transparent, they still scatter a few light away. And in the fovea area, they want to have the sharpest vision. So the compromise strategy is they make the ganglia and bipolar cells shine away so the light can directly hit the rods and cones. And in the fovea, it's all cones. The cones are the one give you the color vision, give you the sharpest vision. It's good. It's still not perfect. And, well, FYI, let's look at the retina of human. It looks like this, right? So ganglia, bipolar, cones. And we have a blind spot. And because all the axons need to combine together to hear, and their output, that's the optic nerve. So in this area, you could not put any photoreceptor. And for no photoreceptor, you don't see it. So you actually have a blind spot. The animals, the octopus or squid, they actually have a better eye design than we do. They have a better eyeball. They look smart. Some of them can tell you which soccer team gonna win. So maybe they're very intelligent animals. Who knows? The Earth is covered by 70% water. So maybe they are the dominant one. They're gonna go to school, learn octopus physiology. Yeah. So if you look at their eye, they look like this. And this humans? No, this humans. This is their eye. So they put all the photoreceptor out. When they put all the photoreceptor out, they don't have a blind spot. So if you look at the design, think like an engineer, they actually have better eyes than we do. Okay, let's go back. The photoreceptor, this picture shows you the retina, and that's the photoreceptor. So we call them photoreceptor because they have the pigments. And they are able to pick up the pigments and transfer them into depolarization first. Then it will affect the neurotransmitter release. Then you can have a second cell pick up the neurotransmitter and do the following, generate action potential. And the signal transduction, this is very similar to what we learned in Unit 1 when we talk about the signal transduction. A chemical signal gonna bind with the receptor. And this receptor have a G protein. The G protein will dissociate and activate protein kinase, trigger signal transduction. good signal transduction. The only difference is this in the sensory system, this photoreceptor, they are able to pick up the light. So the first messenger is the light. That's the only difference. And they're very picky about the first messenger. So they only be able to pick up the signal from the 350 to 700 nanometer from the UV, from the purple light to the red light. So we call them visible light. But the concept signal transduction is exactly the same as what we learned before. So we have the rods and cones. Let's look at the difference of these two. We actually have much more rods than cones. And rods, these are the analogy I use is this is a cheap toy. So we have plenty of them. You can afford to have a lot of them. And we put most of them in the peripheral. They are cheap. So actually they are not so good at detecting the, they don't have high resolution. They are more sensitive to light. So you only need a small amount of light. Only one photon you can activate the rod. So they are very good for what? For the dim light. In the night, you use the rod system. But they have a low accuracy. Their resolution is not so high. So if you think about your visual perception, your peripheral visual system actually is you have light, low resolution. You have to use your fovea to see. Fovea, this area with high resolution. So you, all your peripheral, you use the rods. And they have high convergence. We talked about this in previous lecture. So low resolution means high convergence. And also, you only have one kind of rod. So no matter what kind of wavelength hit the rod, it gives you exactly the same response. The red light, the same response. A green one, a blue one, exactly the same response. So they could not tell the light color. They are black and white. So that's the rod system. Now let's look at the cones. Cones are those expensive toys. You could not afford to have too many. So you have much less cones. You put almost all of them in the fovea. In the fovea. So in your fovea, that's the area you have the sharp vision. And only in that very small area. If you want to read, you actually have to move your fovea to the object you want to read. So outside of your eye, you have six muscles, four rectus muscle, two oblique muscle. If you took anatomy, you learn those muscles' name. They're gonna move the fovea. Their job is to move the fovea so you are able to read. So when you read, you actually move the fovea line by line. You could not use your peripheral vision to read. Their resolution is too low. In the fovea area, it's all cones. They are not so sensitive to light. They need more light to activate them. So we use them for daytime vision because in the daytime you have plenty of light. And they have very high acuity, small receptive field, small convergence, almost no convergence. And we cannot afford too many of them. So we put all of them in the fovea. So, and we have three different kinds of cones. We have the red cone, the green cone, the blue cone. So we have a color vision because of the cones. And this is the distribution of the rods and cones from the fovea. This is the fovea. And start to walk away. In the fovea, you found, okay, all cones. All cones. This is a picture I pirated from the other book. This is all cones. And when you start to walk away from the fovea, you found the number of cones significantly decreased. You almost have no cones. But in the peripheral vision, you start to have a lot of rods. You put a lot of rods. So in the peripheral vision, their job is not to see clearly. Their job is to identify the object. And when you need to see clearly, you move your fovea here. So the fovea, that's the area with all cones. And that's the area with the sharpest vision. We say the visual acuity is the highest one. So this picture tells you the visual acuity. For the rods and cones, they have a high visual acuity, so each one has small receptive field, and they have almost no convergence when the signal transduct. We talked about the convergence last time. So when this neuron fire, they know, okay, the brain knows the signal comes from this, so this is the small receptive field, high resolution. For the cones, they have a high convergence, and when the light hits here and here, And when they converge together, eventually it's all the same ganglia cells generate action potential. And your brain have no way to know, okay, well, this come from here or here. They're all the same because all your brain is action potential. So high convergence equals to big receptive field. All this is a receptive field of this neuron and low resolution. Low convergence, small receptive field. Only here is the receptive field and high resolution. Let's take a break.